Okay, we can get started now. Up next, Python bytecode. We rely on it every day. We don't really think about it. So please welcome Larry Hastings to tell us all about it.
Thanks. So is this microphone working okay, or do I need to switch to that one? Okay, this one's more convenient. That way I can wave my hands wildly. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, welcome to All Singing, All Dancing, Python Bytecode. I'm Larry Hastings. I can't see you because of this incredibly bright light shining in my eyes. So this talk is all about Python, specifically, it's an intermediate level talk, I should say. So you need to be familiar with Python. You should be a reasonably conversant Python programmer in order to understand the talk. And it's about Python, specifically CPython. When we say CPython, what we really mean is that's Python. That's the Python you're used to. It's the Python that's written in C, but it's the one that everybody uses. You're not using IronPython or Jython or PyPy. This is about CPython, aka just Python. Specifically, it's about version Python 3.3.0. That was the current version when I wrote the talk. 3.4 isn't going to be out until next February or March or something, and by then I'll probably retire this talk. This is 100% in CPython 3.3. You don't need to understand any C code in order to understand this talk. And the information that's in this talk is roughly applicable to other Python versions and other Python implementations. So Python, like CPython 2.7, that has bytecode and it looks almost identical. I think that the details are going to be beyond anything that are in these slides. So this information is going to be basically applicable to 2.7. It's also going to be kind of roughly applicable to PyPy. PyPy does have a bytecode. It's very similar to CPython's bytecode, although it's not exactly the same. IronPython and Jython, of course, those have completely different bytecodes because the whole purpose of those Python implementations is to use the native bytecode of the JVM or the CLR, depending on what they're running on. So, what is bytecode? In a nutshell, bytecode is a set of instructions for a virtual machine. So, I seem to give this analogy every time I give a talk. Virtual machine is one of those few analogies in computer science that really is pretty apt. It is both virtual and a machine. It's virtual in the sense that it doesn't exist as a set of atoms anywhere you can go over and kick. And it's a machine, and by that we really mean a computer, a virtual computer. So it's a machine in the sense that it has all the attributes of a machine. It has memory, and it has registers, it has a stack pointer, it has an instruction pointer, and it has instructions. And these instructions, when it comes to a virtual machine, we tend to call them bytecode. And part of the reason for that is that they tend to be one byte apiece. That's true in the case of Python. So there are roughly four different kinds of bytecode. I would lump them into roughly four categories. These are pretty rough categories. But there are four that I would say for CPython bytecode. There's stack manipulation operands, which add and remove things from the stack and deal with talking to memory. And I'll get into all of that in a minute. There's flow control operands, which allow you to manipulate the instruction pointer. So that'll be jumps and go-tos and conditional branching and function calls and returns. There are arithmetic operations, so that's going to be plus, minus, times, divide, all of those things, which deal almost exclusively with the stack. And then there's this huge category that I call Pythonic instructions, which deal with things like creating a tuple or creating a set or binding a closure. And then there are even some specialized instructions inside of that set that are just there to make the implementer of CPython's life more convenient. And I'll show you one or two of those in a minute. So if you're wondering, at what point does Python use the bytecode? The answer is all the time. Anytime that you're running Python code inside of the Python interpreter, you're using bytecode. Which means, among other things, every Python program that you run is translated into bytecode before it is run, which means that bytecode can do everything that CPython can, that Python code can. The reverse, by the way, is not true. You can express a concept in bytecode that you cannot express in Python. So for instance, an explicit go-to to a particular location. You really can't do that in CPython per se. So we're 4.5 minutes in, and now I ask the uncomfortable question, why even bother studying bytecode at all? You've lived your life so far, probably not dealing with bytecode very much. Why start now? Well, the really good answer is if you're going to become a core developer. Oh, sorry, I do this almost every single time. I'm on the wrong slide. I don't know why I have this slide here. I really should move it. So the why have bytecode in the first place? Why did we bother? Why did Guido invent bytecode? And the answer is he didn't. Bytecode is a very widely used conceptual thing for implementing an interpreter. Writing an interpreter, as you might imagine, is a terribly complicated problem. And bytecode is a way of divide and conquer. So you take something complicated like a for loop and you break it down into a bunch of little tiny instructions, which are going to call bytecodes. And implementing each of those bytecodes itself is pretty simple. And so this allows you to attack the problem of writing an interpreter and breaking it into lots of little pieces. So everybody uses it. Ruby has bytecode. PHP has bytecode, although it's really crazy. So finally, like I was just getting into, why bother to look at bytecode in the first place? Why study it? And the answer, if there is a good one, is if you're going to be a core developer, it's helpful to understand how the interpreter is implemented and the interpreter uses bytecode. So yes, you would want to understand bytecode at that point. But even then, like most core developers never really touch the bytecode interpreter. So you really kind of even don't have to understand it from that perspective. If you're Antoine Petrou, you would need to understand it, but maybe nobody else. So there are three answers that people often give that they think are a good reason to study bytecode, and I'm not sure that I really buy any of them. This whistling, by the way, I think he's obs, I'm gonna switch the other mic, so if you're getting annoyed, I don't know, stare at me or something. Oh no, that's right, I can't see you. So there are three reasons that people cite why they might want to study bytecode, and I don't think any of them are all that compelling. The usual one is so that you can understand what's really going on inside of the Python interpreter. And my question to that is, where do you stop? If you claim that in order to understand Python, you really need to understand Python bytecode, I would say, well, in order to understand bytecode, you need to understand C, because that's how it's implemented. And to understand C, you really need to understand assembly language. And to understand assembly language, you need to understand the microcode on the Intel processor. And from there, you need to understand transistors, and electricity, and general relativity, and quantum mechanics. And you don't need to understand quantum mechanics to understand Python. So I don't really think that doesn't speak to me. Now, some people like to write hand-tuned bytecode in order to make their programs go a little faster. And I think this is absolutely bafflingly wrong. Python is the language that trades performance for readability. And what you have done here is you've traded an enormous amount of readability for a teeny tiny little performance upgrade. You are so much better off just making your algorithms better or just making your code more readable or something. But writing hand-tuned bytecode in order to make your problems go faster, I never think that's a good idea. You could write a C extension if you're really concerned about performance, or if you're entirely concerned about performance, you should be using another language. Finally, if you're interested in... I see. I've been bad, and he's taken the other microphone away. If you're doing multi-threaded Python, then understanding bytecode can help because the GIL changes threads at the granularity of bytecodes. There are two times when you can switch between threads in Python. One is between any two bytecodes, and it really could be any two bytecodes. And the other is inside of a function call if the call goes into C code, which it almost always, well, depends on, see, this is not my fault. If the function call is implemented in C, then the C code could give up the GIL at almost any time. So like calling read or write on a file handle, something like that, that's going to give up the GIL in the middle, and that could switch between threads. So understanding that could theoretically be helpful if you were doing a lot of heavily multi-threaded code, but it's best to just assume that you can switch threads at almost any time. So we're almost there to talking about real bytecode. But in order to talk about bytecode, I kind of wanted to have a sample function to talk about. So here it is. This is my sample function I'm going to use for the rest of my slides. It's a dumb little function called gunk. You would never, ever want to call it. But I'm going to walk you through it, just because the purpose of this function is just to illustrate a bunch of things about bytecode. So we're going to be talking about the internals of this quite a bit. So gunk takes three arguments. The first one is a positional or keyword argument called A. It takes a default value of 1. Then we have the star args array. Well, we've called that args. That's going to take any additional positional-only parameters. After that, we have a keyword-only argument called b, and it has a default value of 3. Then we call print and pass in args. We create a local variable called c and set it to none. And then we create this pointless little tuple containing a and b added together and c. Now, when you talk about bytecode in Python, it is inevitable you're going to talk about the DIS module. So DIS is short for disassembler. It's a module that's built into Python, and it provides a disassembler for Python code. So this is what DIS output looks like when it's running on gunk. I'm going to walk you through these columns here. There are five columns. This first column, that's the line number offset that the bytecodes occurred at. So it's line numbers 2, 3, and 4. That's followed by the bytecode offset. Now, I've been talking about how it's bytes, and you'll notice that these numbers go up by 3 almost every time. 3, 3, 3, and then the pop-top, that only goes up by 1. Why is it 3 bytes instead of 1? Well, all of these take what's called an op-arg, which is a 2-byte argument that some opcodes take and others don't. I'll talk you all the way through that, or don't worry, we're going to go into exhaustive detail about everything. But just for now, just assume. Let me assume that some bytecodes are 3 bytes and some of them are 1. After that, this is the name of the bytecode. These are formal names assigned by Python, and this actually maps to some integer number somewhere like that. I don't remember what the numbers are. We're going to get to those in a minute. But load global, load fast, and call function and pop top. These are the bytecode instructions themselves, rendered into a readable format for you and me. This is that 2-byte argument that I was talking about. So this is what's called the first one's called the opcode, and then what's following it is called the op-arg. The op-arg, if it's present, is a 2-byte unsigned number. So it's 0 to 65,000. Here these are all nice small numbers. And then this fifth column, this is disk kind of being helpful. The meaning of the op-arg is context dependent. So load global and load fast, the op-arg means different things. This parenthesized thing here, this is kind of hint to you what the op-arg represents for this particular instruction. Now, what I don't like about the disk module is that it doesn't show you enough. So consider for a minute a modern program sitting on a computer like Cat or Chrome or Firefox. So the instructions, the assembly language that makes up that program is an important part of the story, but it's not the complete story. And if all you had were those instructions, you wouldn't be able to make sense of the program, because there's a lot of data and metadata associated with the program, and your program doesn't make sense without that context. So like a C program requires all the static strings that are going to be built in. It'll also require all the static data, the integers and things. If it's a modern program, it's going to need like dialog boxes and pointers and bitmaps and things. And without that associated data and metadata, the program is meaningless. Disk is only showing you the bytecode, more or less. It's showing you a little bit of the metadata associated with it, but it's leaving a lot on the floor. I'll remind you, gunk took 3 parameters, A, B, and args. You don't see any of that here. You can see the name args, but you don't see it represented. You don't know which things are args, which things are A and B. You don't see the default values. You don't know whether they're positional or keyword only. You don't have any idea that args is the star args array. You don't know it's a list. So there's a lot of stuff that it's just not showing you. So in order to really understand bytecode, we're going to have to take the holistic approach. I'm going to talk about not just the opcodes, but I'm also going to talk about the runtime environment, the virtual machine, only at a very high-level detail, because you don't need to know much about it. And I'm going to talk about the data and metadata, and there's going to be a lot of that. So I hope you're all sitting down. You should sit down. So just the opcodes themselves. Opcodes, there are 101 of them in Python. I'm not going to go into them in hardly any detail. There's documentation about them, and I just don't have the time. It's only 40 minutes, and just talking about the stuff I want to talk about, I ran out of time. So each bytecode, the bytecode program itself, conceptually, is a list of bytes. In point of fact, it's actually a byte string in Python 3. In Python 2, it was just a string. That you understand that. So an individual operand is an individual element out of that bytecode array. And that op-arg that I was talking about, if it's present, then it's just the next 2 bytes in the array. So what you do is you take those next 2 bytes, whatever they are, you take the second one, you shift it left by 8, and you OR those things together, and that's your 16-bit unsigned number. Now, how do you know whether a particular op-code takes an op-arg? Well, there's a constant number. It's stored in the disk module for your convenience. It's called have argument. And the way this works is if the opcode is this number or higher, then it takes an op-arg, and if it is lower than this number, it doesn't take an op-arg. So in other words, the size of a particular opcode is 1 if the op is less than have argument, otherwise it's 3. So that's it about opcodes, actually. Although I'll show them to you a bit in just a bit, the real thing. So the virtual machine, from the perspective of the Python programmer, there's really only three things that you need to know about. There's the instruction pointer, which you can manipulate with jump instructions. There is the stack pointer, which you can manipulate with load and store, and the stack itself, of course. The CPython interpreter is what processor architecture people call a stack machine, because it has a data stack, and all the arguments for function call into the stack. You use the stack for a lot of things. It's not really a register machine. There are very few registers, and you don't have direct access to them. So the stack, you manipulate with load and store instructions. And then there's the third thing, it's called the fast locals array. This was something added in the very early days of Python. It wasn't in the very first versions, but it was added like a couple of months later as a speed optimization. Fast locals, those are function arguments and local variables inside of functions are stored in this. The fast locals array is just a Python list. It literally is a Python list. And the way that it works is that all the arguments are stuck into this list before the function is called. And internally, whenever you refer to one of those arguments, it just uses a load fast or store fast instruction to deal with that particular thing. Local variables are also stored there. And this is only a detail that you care about because you need to use these specific bytecode instructions in order to refer to them. So load fast and store fast. So let me show you the stack real quick, in case you haven't seen these sorts of diagrams before. Python has a stack. It's a general purpose object stack, so you can store any object on it. Or what you're storing is actually a reference to the object. So load is how you get up values onto the stack. They take a reference to an object that already exists somewhere in memory, and there are like six different kinds of memory we're going to see. And it takes a reference to that thing and adds a new reference to the top of the stack. So the stack, I should say, in case you have never seen it before, a stack, you can think of it like, kind of like being a stack of dishes. You don't deal with the internals of the stack. You only deal with the top thing at any particular time. So you push on top of the stack or you pull something off of the top of the stack. So as an example, here's a sample stack. At the bottom of the stack, we have a tuple with an arbitrary amount of stuff in it. And then on top of that, we have a callable object called print. And we're going to push a 3 onto the stack with a load instruction. So golly, there it went. There it goes. The symmetric operation is called store. That takes the value off the top of the stack and stores it off into memory somewhere. So that would look kind of like this. A slightly less uninteresting example would be binary add. Binary add takes the top two things off of the stack, pulls them off, uses dunder add or dunder r add, depending on what works, in order to add the two things together. So if we had 12 and 17 on the top of the stack, binary add would pull both of those off. It would go off somewhere in performance computation and it would push the result 29 back onto the top of the stack. So there are six different places where you can store and load from in Python. Global and built-in variables, or global and built-in values, I should say, you load and store those with something called load global. So these, I'm going to go through the six different kinds and I'm going to talk about load, but there's always a symmetric store as well, and with one exception, and I'll get to that. But there's load global, there's also store global. All of these load and store instructions, they all take an op arg, and the op arg is context dependent on the instruction. So with load global, for instance, the op arg is an index into a special array that's associated with the callable function. The array is called names. It's actually co underscore names. And I'll show you where that lives in a minute. But it is a Python list. And actually, it's a Python tuple because it has to be immutable. So it's a Python tuple, and this number is an index into that tuple to pull out a string, because load global is loading something with a name, and the name is stored in the names array, and it's always a string. I'm sorry, that was a terrible explanation. But we'll see how it works in a minute. So fast locals, that's similar. That's load fast and store fast. And that index is just an index directly into that fast locals array that I told you about. That's created every time you call a function. Local variables, and I'm going to call these slow locals just to differentiate them. So this was the original mechanism that was used for local variables before Guido added fast locals. But it's still used in Python. It's used when you're running code inside of a class, or if you're running code inside of a module, or if you're calling eval, I think. And those are loaded and stored with load name. And this load name, the op arg, is again an index into that names array, which is a tuple containing strings. Constants are loaded with load const. They are not stored. There is no store const bytecode. Otherwise, it'd be terrible constants. They wouldn't be constant values anymore. Load const, the op arg, is an index into a constants array, which is stored with the callable object. Object attributes, those are loaded and stored with load adder and store adder. You push the object reference onto the top of the stack, and then the argument to load adder, that's again an index into the names array, which is going to be the name of the attribute that we're looking up or storing. And finally, cell variables are loaded and stored using load deref and store deref, and I'm going to talk about those on the next slide. Although not very much, because I don't actually understand them that well. But these are things that you have dealt with before. Free variables and cell variables have to deal with closures and or nested functions. So consider for a minute this function here, foo. There are three variables defined inside, four if you count the function bar itself, but I'm going to ignore that for now. So we have three variables inside, A and B, and inside of bar we also have another variable which is also called B. So from the perspective of Python, A is a local variable, that's all it is. It's just simply a local variable. B is a cell variable. A cell variable in Python means a local variable which is referred to inside of a nested function. And inside of bar, our nested function, B is a free variable. Now, free variable, this is a general compiler term, but specifically in the context of Python, a free variable is a local variable that is defined in an outer function. So there's some funny mechanisms that go on behind the scenes in order to make all of this work. I don't understand any of it. I'm moving on. Like I said, I only have 40 minutes to give this talk anyway. So now we have all of the data and metadata associated with a function, and I think there's about seven slides worth of all this stuff. So I'm going to be talking about gunk specifically. The type of gunk itself, it's what's called a function object. It lives in type stuff, function type, and if you do a wrapper on it, it says it's class function. So that's an object that is callable. And if we look inside of gunk and we see all the stuff inside, there's a lot of it. All of the things that I've made bold and a little bit bigger, those are the ones that are specific to function objects. And I'm going to go over every single one of these in a minute, so don't write them down. You're not going to be tested. But I want to draw your attention to one of these in particular, the dundercode object. Dundercode is a specific thing to deal with code objects in Python. A code object is something that's stored inside of a function object, and it has a whole bunch of more metadata associated with it. This time they all start with CO underscore. So these are the fields that are just inside of code objects that deal with callable objects. Now this gives rise to the question, why bother having both? If every function object contains a code object inside of it, why don't we just get rid of the code object and just have the function object? Now I thought the answer to that was because code objects are marshallable and function objects are not marshallable. And of course that begs the question, what is marshallable object? So marshall is a module that's built into Python. You might not have used it ever. I sort of hope you haven't. It's a binary serialization format, kind of like pickle, but it changes it can change violently from Python version to Python version. There are no guarantees given about it being stable. It could change from 3.3 to 3.3.1, actually, because there are just no guarantees. So what's it for? It is the storage format of .pyc files on the disk. A .pyc file contains, as of Python 3.3, it contains literally these contents. A 4-byte 32-bit integer in network format, which is a magic number that says this is a 3.3.0 PYC file. That's followed by a 4-byte date and timestamp, a number of seconds since the epoch 1970, followed by a 32-bit integer that's the size of the original PY file. And that's followed by one binary serialized marshaled Python code object. So Python code objects have to be marshallable. Marshall is a serialization format. It only deals with a certain limited subset of Python objects, and it's not something that you should ever use. As an example, here are four fields on the function object that cannot be marshaled. They can contain data that is not marshallable. So I thought this was the answer. I actually asked Guido, and he said, no, that's not the answer. The reason that we have this distinction between function objects and code objects is for nested functions. I'll remind you on that previous slide, we had foo, and inside of that we had bar. Every time you call foo, it's going to create a new bar object. And there are a lot of fields, as I've already shown you, inside of a callable object inside of Python. Recreating every single one of those, every time you call a function that has a nested function, would be time consuming. So what Guido did is a speed up optimization way back in the early days of Python. he created the second function object and the code object. In the code object, he put all the fields that never change, all of the immutable fields. And then the function object gets all the fields that can change or that are very dynamic and change from runtime to runtime. So function, in general, fields that are on the function object are going to contain mutable things or things that are live data that change or that are assigned inside of the running Python interpreter. And then the code object is going to contain all the immutable stuff that never changes that's relevant to the callable object. So we're going to start breaking that down. This is the first of seven slides just on the data and metadata inside of the function. Again, I hope you're sitting down. And sorry, it's still early, and it's too early in the day. I'm not sure there's a good time of day to talk about seven slides of metadata about functions, but here we are. So this is why you're all here. This is the bytecode for gunk. That's it. It's really exciting looking. It's a binary string in Python 3, so it has that B in front, and that's followed by a completely unreadable mess. This is a slightly more readable format. These are all the individual bytes from each of it. So 116, for instance, that's low global, and that's followed by 00. That's the two-byte op-arg that we're going to OR together. I have it in my notes here. Let's see. The next one is load fast. That's 124. That's followed by 20. So that's those two bytes that turn into the number 2. So we're loading the second argument, actually, which was we were calling print and we're passing in arg. So that's arg. So this still isn't terribly readable in this format. But, like I said, DIS will disassemble it for you. It's actually not hard to write your own disassembler, so here it is. This is a disassembler for Python code that fits on a single slide. And I'm going to walk you through it real quick. Well, we import DIS. I didn't put a red rectangle around it. I guess I wanted to talk about it. But DIS is the disassembly module, and we need a couple of constant values from that. So disassemble, pass in the callable. I printed a nice line for the first line that says def, and then the name of the function, colon. And then I pull out the bytecode. I call that program. I could have called it bytecode. I have this is, I is going to be my index into the bytecode. I'm going to be stepping through it. And then while I haven't hit the end of the program, I pull out the bytecode. If it's less than half argument, then I don't have an op arg, and so I just print out an empty string there, and I advance by one. Otherwise, I pull out the op arg and OR them together properly, and then advance by three. And then I look up that name inside of op name. So I have the bytecode itself. Op name is a map of bytecode numbers into bytecode strings. And then I print out the op arg afterwards. I print it with a couple of spaces just to indent it. And here is what that looks like if I pass in the disassembler itself. So we get load fast 0, load adder 0, load adder 1. Most of the time, op codes take an op arg. Those are the really useful ones. Pop top doesn't, binary add doesn't, return value all the way end of the function doesn't. So, back to the second of seven. These are fields that deal specifically with arguments to the function. CO underscore arg count, that's the number of positional or keyword arguments. So that would be A in the case of a gunk. KW only arg count, that's the number of keyword only arguments. This would be B. CO underscore N locals, that's the total number of local variables. That's the total number of fast locals. And I'll remind you, that's both arguments and local variables defined in the function, so there's four here. There's A, B, args, and C. And you can see those names actually in this var names array. And again, these are all things that never change. These are all stuck in the code object. So A, B, args, and C. Then the order of when they were defined, actually, it was A, args, B, and C, but Python reorders them. KW args always goes at the end, and then args goes in front of that if you have one. Both of those are optional, actually, I should say. So default values for the function, these could change from run to run because they're computed, so they start in the code object. Defaults, this is a tuple, and this is just storing the bare minimum. So the way that it works is, let's say that you had a function, you had five positional or keyword arguments, and three of them took default values. This would be a tuple of three things. So you'd basically take it, you shift it to the right, and you assign it up like that. KW defaults, that's default values for keyword-only arguments. B had a default value of 3, and so we can see that here. Global and const tables, these are those tables I kept talking about over and over. So here's the names table. Print, we look up with load global. Load global took an op arg of 0. 0 is an index into this table, the CO names table. Now this none that's here, this is really funny, actually. This is leftover garbage from the tokenization phase. it's not actually referred to inside of the function, and it will never be referred to inside of the function. It's just leftover junk. And I asked about it, and they were like, who cares? So one of these days, maybe it'll go away. But for now, you're going to see it there. So the const table, this again is a tuple of constant values, and this is the real none that we refer to. When we use none inside of our function, we're going to load const 0. 0 is going to be an index into this tuple, and we get none. Line numbers, hopefully you'll never have to deal with this because this is kind of a headache. It used to be in Python a long time ago that there was an opcode instruction that said, now we're on line 5, now we're on line 6, now we're on line 7. And it turns out you don't want that because you only need line numbers when you need a traceback. And when you have a traceback, you've given up any hope of your program being performant at that point, and you're going to like bring everything to a stop, and you're going to print out this thing to the stream, and it's not really a performance-sensitive operation. Having those bytecode instructions saying what line number you were on, that slowed things down a little bit. And so they got rid of those, and instead they store it in this difficult-to-use format where you sort of reverse look up the line number that you're on, you figure, or you reverse look up what bytecode you're on, you figure out what line number it maps to. This is how you figure that out. So there are two fields. This is the first line number, and that's followed by this thing called the L and O tab. Then that's short for line number table. This is the headache for everybody. Again, here it is in a slightly more readable format. The way this works, it's pairs of bytes, and these are offset of, let's see, where is that? Where'd my cursor go? Right, it's the delta for the bytecode followed by the delta for the line number. So you would go forward by 10 bytes to get to the second line number. And there are a lot of specific rules about how the line number table has to be formatted, and it's a big headache, and you should hope that you never have to live your life without ever dealing with this. So moving on, I think this is about 5 out of 7. All of this random metadata associated with the callable function. The dunder globals, this is a reference to the dictionary that is the dict of the object that the scope the function was defined in, aka the module. So effectively, whenever you call a function, you know how if you took a function and you paste it in a reference to it inside of another module and you call it, the function still knows about its original module that it's from. When it says load global A, it looks inside of the module where it was defined. It doesn't look inside of the new module. That's because it carries a reference to its globals around with it everywhere it goes. This is it, dunder globals. Module, this is just the name the module was defined in, just for reference. CO underscore file name, again, that's the name of the file was defined in, just for reference for tracebacks and things. Name of the function itself is gunk. And flags, this is one of the least documented areas of bytecode. This number 71 is a mildly magical number. I'm going to break that down in a slide or two. For now, let's just live our lives and we'll move on. Two more slides left, I think. Oh, wait, that's right. I have stack size here. Stack size, this is a hint to the Python interpreter. This says the deepest that the data stack will ever go when you're calling this function is 2, in the case of gunk, because we're doing a binary add. The way that Python works internally is it actually, the CPython specifically, pre-allocates the stack for every function call. And in fact, it's actually tucked on the end of that fast locals array. So it allocates one array for every function, which contains local variables, arguments, and the stack. This helps Python also to know in advance if it's going to run out of stack space for calling a function. That's how it can print a nice traceback, because it actually hasn't run out of memory yet, because it checks in advance. It's very un-Pythonic, but it looks before it leaps. So one or two more slides left, I think. This one's real quick. Actually, no, this is the last slide, and this is real quick because they're all empty. Annotations, these are the CPython 3 annotations. You can annotate a function with colons and values and things. Gunk is unannotated, so it's an empty dict. If gunk was a closure, this would be a data structure of some kind or other. It's not, so it's none. And cell vars and free variables, gunk is neither a nested function nor does it contain any nested functions. Therefore, these are both empty tuples. And again, I don't even understand what would go in there if it was. So we're finally through the woods, and we're going to talk about something slightly more interesting. So here's something I find interesting about Python. Everything is a callable object. Consider for a moment a function that you define inside of Python. You say def foo, and then you have arguments and so on and so forth. Well, consider that a module is actually a callable object as well. When you import a module, you have all of that code inside of the module. Python actually runs it. Well, in order for Python to run, it needs to be a callable object. Effectively, it needs to be a function. So if a module was a function, it would look like this. It doesn't, because there is no a point that you say def and then the name of the module. But this is what it would look like. And effectively, all of your code would just be in that dot, dot, dot. All of your local variables would be load fast and store fast. And at the end of the module, it would have this pair of instructions, load const none and return value. That's because every time you have a callable object inside of Python, it always has to return a value. Modules don't return anything interesting, so it just returns none every time. So by the same token that modules are callable objects, classes are also callable objects. These are slightly more complicated. This is the extra code that lives inside of a class callable object in order for it to actually work. Again, this dot, 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 that's going to be all of your code that exists inside of class scope. But at the top, I'm going to walk your way through the bottom to the top, I think, because it's just a little bit easier that way. It gets more complicated the higher we go. So at the end, we have the same two instructions because classes are callable objects. Callable objects always return a value. It always returns none. Then we have all of your code. Then we have load const none, store name, qual name. Dunder qual name, that's this new thing that's the fully qualified name of a thing. This didn't happen to have an interesting name, so it just gets none. Load name, name, store name, module. That's storing the name of the object, and it's been stored in a slow local variable called name, which is an attribute on the module. And then we have this load fast zero store locals. Well, unlike modules, classes actually take an argument, which is this dunder locals thing. Load fast zero, that's going to load the first argument. That's dunder locals. Store locals, this is one of those highly Pythonic instructions that's there for the convenience of the implementer. But what does it do? Well, this has to do with something called dunder prepare. That's a new thing in Python 3. In Python 2, whenever you created a class, the class variables were always stored inside of a dict. And by that, I mean a real, honest-to-goodness Python curly braces dictionary. And some people wanted the ability to use a dict-like object as the storage for variables inside of a class. And for some reason, it was important to have that be part of initialization instead of just copying everything over and pushing it there later. So there's this new thing that you can do inside of a meta class called dunder prepare that allows you to return a dict-like object that's going to be used as the real dict for a real class. And this is the mechanism that it gets in there. So it gets passed in as an argument to the class, and we call the store locals. That takes the top thing off of the stack and stores it as the locals dict for the slow locals for the current scope of the thing that's running. So now you know, in case you ever want to write your own classes by hand, I don't think you do. Now, at the time that you actually bind the class to the name inside of module scope, at this point is what we're talking about, there's a little bit of boilerplate that gets spat out every time here. So I'm going to walk you down from the top to the bottom. Load build class, this is another one of those highly specialized instructions. This pushes a callable object onto the top of the stack called dunder build underscore class, which again is very barely documented. I'm going to get to that in another minute, but just assume for now, at the bottom of the stack is a callable object called build class. On top of that, we push a code object, and again, this is a serializable object. So a code object is just a static object called class name. We're going to load the string class name, and we're going to call this function make function. Make function, the op arg make function, what it does is it takes a code object and turns it into a function object. The op arg for make function represents two things. It's actually a couple of numbers sort of ored together. It's the number of default values for positional arguments and default values for keyword-only arguments. Since classes don't take either of those, the number is always zero. So make function, when it's done, there will be a brand new function object sitting at the top of the stack. And below that, I'll remind you, is dunder build underscore class. So we push on top of that, load const class name. So we push the name of the class again as a string. And now we call function 2. Call function, again, the op arg is the number of keyword arguments ORed with the number of positional or keyword arguments. This number 2 means there are two arguments. Those two arguments are the string class name, we just saw load const, and the callable function, the function object that we created from make function. So those are the two arguments to the actual thing we're going to call, which is build class. Build class does all of the work of actually making all of the class object-y things and calling dunder prepare and all those things. And then it finally, when it's ready, calls into the callable object that represents your code. Your code is that code object that's been turned into a function object. and we finally run the code for real, and when call function returns, on the top of the stack is sitting the class object. In case you ever write your own Python on top of Python, that's all very helpful information. So, this is a little bit more interesting. I'm going to create, in four lines, a Python object from scratch. It's going to have, it's going to be a real callable object, it's going to do real work, it's just not readable. So here it is. Those are the four lines right there. Code object equals types.codetype. I pass in a bunch of baffling parameters. And then I take the result of that, the code object, I pass it into function type. I'm passing in the reference to the globals array, because again, function objects carry their reference to their globals around with them wherever they go. The result of this is called add, which I've very cleverly called add, because what it does is it takes two parameters and adds them together and returns the result. And it really works. This will print 5. Now, this is entirely unreadable, so I'm going to do it again across four slides, but more readable this time. So, this time I need a lot more symbolic values. I inspect and dis and types. That's going to contain relevant information. Oops. Did I hit the... No. Sorry, I didn't want to skip that yet. Go back. Go back. Go forward. Okay. Dismap get, that's opmap, that's a mapping of the names of bytecodes into their bytecode numbers, and I'm going to pull off the dot get function off of that. So I'm just calling op here, load fast, that's going to turn into a number for load fast 126. So this is the bytecode program. I'm creating a byte string out of this array of bytes. So load fast 00, load fast 10, that's going to push the first and second arguments onto the top of the stack. Binary add is going to pull those two things off, add them together, push the result, and return value is going to return whatever's at the top of the stack back to the Python interpreter. So that's our add program right there. But again, we have a lot of associated metadata, and here it all is. There are two arguments, which I'm calling A and B. You can see them in the varnames list there. So A and B are the arguments. There are no keyword-only arguments. There are no local variables. The total number of locals is arg count plus kw-only arg count plus local count, so it's actually going to be 2. Max stack depth is 2 because we push two things onto the stack. Here is the flags variable. I told you I was going to explain it sooner or later. It really doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So inspect.co optimize, that means literally that this is not an unoptimized function. That's what the documentation seemed to imply when I was reading the source code. These two things really mean about the same thing. What new locals means is we're using the fast locals array. CO optimized also kind of more or less means we're using the fast locals array. Code objects for classes don't use the fast locals array. Actually, classes they do because of the fast local. Yes. For classes you do. For modules you don't. And then if you have something that was created by eval, it would not have fast locals. So it would not have these flags set. But generally you have both of those set at the same time. This last one, CO underscore no free. That means this function is not a closure, nor does it contain a closure. We don't have free variables. We don't have serial variables. This is an optimization of Python that says you can skip a lot of the initialization of that stuff because we just don't have it. So that makes things go a little faster. Constants, names, free vowels, and cell vars, those are all empty, so those all get the same empty tuple. Var names A and B, again, those are the names of the local variables, aka the arguments in this case. I just said file name is standard in because I'm a liar. Name is add, first line number is 1, L1O tab is empty, so if this code ever crashes, the traceback is not going to be helpful, I'm very sorry. And then this page is more or less the same as the first page, except that now we're using the symbolic names for all those different arguments, passing in the right spots. But the call is the same, code type, and we get the code object out, and this line is exactly the same. We get the callable add function out as a result. And we can call it, and it really prints 2 and 3 added together really does print 5. But that was pretty miserable. So that is why, in the process of writing this talk, I wound up writing my own assembler and disassembler for Python. I call it Maynard. I'll remind you, Maynard is the keeper of the holy hand grenade, which I would describe as the finest disassembler known to man or beast. So very quickly, here is Maynard run on gunk. So it prints out def gunk. It prints out arg A1. So that shows you A is a positional or keyword argument. Name A, the default value of 1. KW only B3, that's a keyword only argument. Name B with the default value of 3. Star args, that's going to be args, and its name is args. It looks redundant, but it's not. Global and print, global and none, because those are the entries in the globals array. Const, const, none. I have to come up with a sort of a symbolic name for all the things in the const table, so I call it const none. But that's all the entries in the const array. Local C, that's our local variable named C. And then now, I think these are a little bit more readable. Load global print, load fast args, call function 1. I may do something about call function 1 one of these days, I don't know. Pop top, load const none. This is, I argue, a lot more readable, and it gives you an idea of a lot more of the metadata associated with the callable object. So this makes a lot more sense. I have people who are saying, you should clean it up and put it in the standard library. And I'm like, maybe someday. So in case you ever want to fiddle around with disassembling a class or a module, I think a module, it might be really hard to get your hands on it. If you wanted to disassemble a class, it's not actually too hard. The eventual thing with Maynard is going to be that it actually recursively disassembles things. So if you have a module object and you recursively disassemble it, it'll show you all the classes. Inside the classes, it'll call you the functions. If the function had a nested function, it'll show you that. One of these days, I'll get around to it. But for now, Maynard just doesn't recursively disassemble anything. It'll just show you the code objects. So if you wanted to take a class and disassemble it and see what it looked like, this is what I actually did in order to show you some of the stuff in this slides. If you want to disassemble a class, the easy thing to do with Maynard is just to throw it inside of a function, then disassemble the function. It'll show you at some point, const index 1, code object h. That's your big hint. This is the code object for the class h. And then you would just point Maynard at disassembling that thing you pulled straight out of the function, co_code consts. Pull it straight out of the const table, pass it in Maynard, and it'll happily disassemble it for you. So very quickly, just to prove that Maynard was slightly useful, I wrote a fourth interpreter on top of the Python VM using Maynard. So it's actually using Python assembly code. It's a pretty minimal fourth, but it does support these basic literal types for strings, integers, and floats. It supports all of these built-in fourth words, which is kind of the equivalent of a Python function. And it does support recursion. And this is barely enough to get you implementing the Fibonacci generator. Because I feel like you don't have a real language until you have a Fibonacci generator. So this really does run inside of Perth, inside of the Python interpreter, using bytecode. But it's really slow, in case you like slow code. It does some really stupid things inside. So let's bring this all together. I'm going to show you a Python VM written entirely in Python. It's going to take me 5 slides to do it. In order to give it something to do, I'm going to call fib. So again, like I said, you don't have real language until you can run a Fibonacci generator, and gunk is really boring and pointless, so it's not bothered. So instead, our Python VM written in Python is going to be able to handle this program, literally written in Python using literal Python bytecode. So here we go. Def VM, this is our virtual machine function. You pass in the callable object, and you pass in a number of positional-only parameters. I pull those into a list called star args. So the code, that's the bytecode for the function. Constants, that's the constants table. That's the names array. That's the code object. Let's see, code is the code object. Program is the bytecode. Number of locals is the total number of local variables. Again, that's going to be the arguments and the locals. Globals dict. Oh, I have these red rectangles. I forgot. Globals dict, that's the globals dict I'm going to be using for whenever I do globals lookups. And built-ins dict, that's going to be the diction I use for built-in lookups. Those are both for the load globals keyword bytecode. The instruction pointer is 0. The local variables, I initialize that to the arguments that came in, plus a special uninitialized value for all of the local-only variables. I don't remember if fib has any or not. I don't think it does. And then the stack is just going to be a Python list, because all we need to do is push and pop from the top. So the rest of this VM is going to be the implementation. It's going to be one big while loop and then if statements to implement particular bytecodes. So while true, pull off the bytecode in advance by 1. If we have an argument, then pull out the next 2 bytes, or them together properly to create the op arg and advance by another 2. Now we're ready to go. If the opcode is load const, look in the constants array, indexed by the op arg, take that value, whatever it is, and push it on the top of the stack. If we're load fast, we do almost the same thing. We take the locals array, we look up inside by op arg, we take the value, whatever it is, and we push on the top of the stack. If the opcode is load global, we take that op arg, we look it up in the names array, and that gives us a string. Now we have a string to look up. If that string is in the globals dict, we take that value, whatever it is, we push it at the top of the stack. Otherwise, we look in the built-in dict, and whatever it is, we push it on the top of the stack. If it's not in either of those, I'm going to throw a terrible exception. This is a terribly fragile interpreter. I suggest you don't use this in production. I keep forgetting I have these red rectangles. Here we go. It's really slow. There we go. So if our opcode is binary add, we take the top two things off the stack, pop them both off, add them together, push the result on the top of the stack. Same thing for the subtract, except it's a minus instead of a plus. Pop jump if false. What this does is, if the top value on the stack is false, then we jump to the op arg. Otherwise, we do nothing. So if not stack pop, if the top value of the stack is false, then we set the instruction pointer to the op arg. This is our go-to instruction. I'll remind you again, this is why we broke down, this is why Python uses bytecode, because you can, these individual instructions are really simple, but taken all together, you get an interpreter out of it. So compare op, this is the most complicated single instruction. It takes two arguments. This compare op, this maps to double equals, less than, greater than, all those comparison operators. It's the rich comparison op arg. So you pop off the top two things you're going to compare, and then the op arg is the operation that you're going to perform. LT, pi LT, that means less than, so the value is going to be a V less than W, the is the next top thing less than the top thing. Less than or equal to, same deal, more or less, else I print out a nice exception, but I don't do that because we're only ever running fib on it, so I append to the top of the stack, I push to the top of the stack the binary result of that comparison, whether it was true or false. Last slide of these five. If the op code is call function, then we're going to call a function recursively, as it turns out, because all we ever handle is fib. The op arg is the number of keyword-only arguments and the number of positional arguments, or together. If the number is greater than 255, then we have some keyword arguments. I don't handle keyword arguments, so I throw an exception. Otherwise, this op arg is the number of arguments, of positional arguments on the stack. I take all of those arguments, I just pop them off, and I stick them into an args array. I pop off the callable thing, because that's the next thing on the stack. And I call the VM recursively, passing in the callable and splatting in the star args array. The return value from the VM function, that's going to be the return code from the function that we called. And I just take that and I push it on the top of the stack. And finally, if the operation is return value, I throw an assertion if there's any other junk left on the stack. There shouldn't be. And in fact, Python doesn't bother to do this, so I don't know why I bothered. But I just basically take the top thing off the top of the stack, whatever it is, and I return that from the virtual machine. That's it. In those five slides, we implemented a working Fibonacci generator, a working Python interpreter that is able to run the real Fibonacci generator function that I wrote in real Python. Here it is. If I iterate over a range of 20, I'm printing out fib of n, and I print out fib of n, I'm calling the real Python version. Then I call my virtual machine and pass in that same function and pass in that same n, I get the same results out. It's just a lot slower. So we're in the home stretch here. If you ever feel like experimenting with bytecode yourself, you should expect to see this a lot. The Python interpreter is absolutely not guaranteed to be resistant to malformed bytecode. I have tried to interest other core developers in making it a little more resistant. I say, well, we could do it for free. It wouldn't make the Python interpreter any slower. And they're like, you get what you deserve if you hack on bytecode. So if you want to read up more about this stuff, you want to take a look at the DIS module, of course, but the inspect module also has a bunch of constants that you're going to need. And in fact, there's one or two that are stored in the future module that have to do with the flags that you would need if you really wanted to do everything. If you want to look at Maynard, it's on Bitbucket. It's also on PyPI, although that version's out of date. Not by a lot. I haven't done a lot of work on it recently. That's right. Yes. And then there is C eval if you do read C. This is the it's basically that VM that I wrote. This is the real Python VM. It's all in one file. It's an enormous function called eval frame ex, pi eval underscore eval frame ex. And then if you wanted to read that written in nice readable Python, just as an instructive tool, a guy named Ned Batchelder, who's a lovely guy, he's been writing a Python VM in real Python, but he actually handles everything. He handles cell variables and free variables and all those sorts of things. And so that's a project on GitHub called ByteRun. And that's it. I think there's 5 minutes left for questions, maybe. Does anybody have any questions, or would you rather go to lunch?
I have one question. The stack hinting that you mentioned at one point.
The stack size, yes.
Yeah, stack size hinting.
Yes.
Does that advise the GC on any stuff? The GC running completely by itself?
The GC, by the GC you mean the garbage collector? Okay, no, so the stack, not really. So the GC, it would have to know what the contents of the stack are in order to find those references so that it could see all of the objects that are actually in use. So I guess, yes, it has to have visibility into the stack. Beyond that, I don't... I'm not a garbage collection expert, so I don't know what advise means in this context. But yes, I think the garbage collector needs to understand that the stack is there and needs to understand the mechanism, it needs to understand where all the pointers are to Python objects that are still alive. The stack contains some live objects, so yes, it needs to know about it. I don't know beyond that. Okay?
Larry?
Yeah?
Thanks for all the information.
You're welcome.
The slide that said, why should we care about bytecode? I think
yes.
You dodged the question. I don't think you answered it. Why should we care?
No, I said you shouldn't.
You should?
Yeah.
Okay,
I said you should if you're going to be a core developer. You should if you really want to understand the granularity of threading. And then the other two reasons that I gave I don't agree with. So I think for the most part, you've all been wasting your time.
Thanks very
much.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes?
Can you give us
Oh, it's been a long time since I looked at Java bytecode. It's about the same. I mean, bytecode tends to be bytecode. So they're going to have a binary add instruction. They're going to have a jump instruction. They're going to have a conditional jump instruction. There are some specific instructions with Java, for instance, for a cast. A cast operator turns into a bytecode at some point. And beyond that, I don't know much. A more entertaining is the PHP bytecode. It's not serializable to disk. It's a C structure that's about 220 bytes long. It contains not only the opcode itself, but then it also contains, they were trying to be like RISC. It contains operand one, operand two, and place you're gonna store the result. And each of those is a union that itself is like 60 or 80 bytes because it has all sorts of detailed, complicated stuff inside of it. So. I think the Python approach of saying load from here, load from there, do the operation, store from here, breaking it up, do sort of, you know, risky as opposed to, I guess PHP is more like CISC and Python is more like RISC. And breaking it up that way I think is just better. Yes. Yes. I guess he's picking.
They say that there are 101 different bytecodes.
Yes.
A lot of the numbers you showed us were bytecodes in the 120, 130 range.
Yes. No, they're not assigned randomly. Once it's assigned, it more or less never changes. We could theoretically change them from version to version, but we don't. But the way that it works is that they picked a nice high number for have argument, 90. And so there aren't 90 instructions that don't take opcodes. There are 30 or 40 or something. It's a little on the sparse side. They try to group them together sometimes, too. It doesn't make any sense. I really wouldn't worry about how those are assigned.
So I have a two-fold question.
Okay.
One is, when, at what point is bytecode generated?
At the point the bytecode is generated. It's generated if you say import on something that hasn't been bytecode, like turned into a PYC file yet, then it's going to generate.